Okay, today in our last class we have come across the convolution, the analytical convolution as well as graphical convolution, plus we discussed some properties of convolution. Now today I want to switch over to another thing which is also related to the concept of convolution in some way or other. What is that? That is the step response. Okay. What is that? It is given by YST equal to integration H lambda D lambda minus infinity to T. Okay. This is the step response of a system whose impulse response is HT, where HT is the impulse response, okay, of an LTI system. I already discussed this thing, already explained. Now for a causal LTI system, okay, our YST will be equal to H lambda D lambda 0 to T. That is for negative time T, H is 0, or for negative lambda, H is 0. We already know. Now let's see one problem. Okay. Find the step response of an LTI system whose impulse response is given by HT equal to U, T plus 1 minus U, T minus 1. Right. Okay. So, first we plot H lambda versus lambda. Now what is our H lambda? Just T will be replaced by lambda. So at lambda equal to minus one, one step starts. And that step will be cancelled by another lambda. Another step which is applied at one, that is lambda equal to one. It's a negative step. It is applied when a negative step is applied at lambda equal to 1. So it is cancelled. So we already know this particular thing. Then we want to integrate it. Integration H lambda D lambda minus infinity to T. Our H is not causal, because for negative lambda also we are getting some value, non-zero value. So H is not causal. Therefore, our integration will be from minus infinity. It will be not from zero. Now, so we want to integrate it. Integration H lambda D lambda minus infinity to T. First we take, now our lower limit is minus infinity, but what's about our upper limit? Upper limit is T. First, we assume that our upper limit T is somewhere here. We assume that T is less than minus 1. Any value, but less than minus 1. So, as T is less than minus 1, it is left to minus 1. So, our H is 0. So from minus infinity to up to t, our h is zero. So its integration will be zero. So when t increases here, it is zero. As soon as our t is greater than minus one, what will happen? Say t is greater than equal to minus one. Then what will happen? Say we assume that t is in between minus one to plus one. So t is somewhere here now. So when t is somewhere here, our integration will be from minus infinity to up to that t. So up to this. So its area will be that one. So what is this area? Area is 1 into t. So area is 1 into, its width is what? Upper edge is at t and lower edge is at minus 1. So this is our area. So this is at t and lower end is minus 1. So it will be 1 into, so it is 0 here when t is less than minus 1 and upper limit is 1 into t minus of minus 1. T minus of minus 1. So better I write it here. Because it's not, it is 0 when t is minus 1. This is 1 into t minus of minus 1. So t is from minus 1 to 1. So just I cross out this. So this is, so it is that one. So which is what? T plus 1. So ultimately the area. So as soon as t is crossing minus 1, the area increases. So integration is nothing but the area. So when we plot the integration, basically we plot the area of the original function. I repeat, plotting the integration means plotting the area of the original function. So area increases. So area increases this way. So the area increases from, note that when our t is here at zero, what will be the area? Area will be the total thing, which is what? 1 into this t minus of minus 1, that. So you put t equal to 0. So area will be what? 1 into 1. So area will be 1. So by putting different values of t, we can find out the area. Now when t is here, area will be now again more than this. Again t is here, area is again that one. So this is way, the t increases here. Now when t is 1, what is the area? Area is 1 into that much. T minus or minus 1. So put t equal to 1. So area will be 1 into 2. So area is just 2. After that, what will happen? When t is here? So when t is greater than equal to 1, what happens? So the area will be minus infinity to up to 1. The area will be remaining there. So area will be constant. Although our t increases beyond 1, okay, the area does not increase anymore because our h is 0 now. Only the old area will be confined in the computation. So it will be saturated. So no more area will be added when t is greater than 1. Get my point? So this is our step response. Clear? So that is the step response. Now if you differentiate it, what you will get? In a reverse way, the slope is what? The slope is 2 by 2. Slope 1, so slope is 1 in that thing. After that, slope 0, slope 0. Here before slope 0, slope 0. So by differentiating this, we get back that one. Clear? So that is the step response. So this is the step response of the original thing. So that is the plot of step response. Note that, if we compute h lambda d lambda from minus infinity to plus infinity, what it will be? Okay? Now, so it will remain what? It will be 2. when t is greater than equal to 1, the area will be saturated at the value 2, that one. Now if we compute the definite that particular integral minus infinity to plus infinity, what it will be? Only that area will be always there, minus infinity to plus infinity. Only these area will be there, so 1 into 2. So it will be simply 2. So when you integrate it from minus infinity to plus infinity, you get a constant value. But if you integrate it from minus infinity to the upper limit t, then the result of integration will be a function of t. So this will be a function of t, but that one will not be a function of t. Clear? So this will be our step response, not that one. Clear? So that is this. Again, let's see one more thing. Find the find minus infinity to t delta lambda d lambda. You have to find out this. Now if we plot, say lambda, delta lambda versus lambda, what it will be? It is one impulse function. Now we integrate it. What it will be? Integration delta lambda d lambda minus infinity to t. First we take t here. So integration delta lambda d lambda minus infinity to t. First we take t less than 0. T is left to 0. So what will be the area? Area is minus infinity to that t, where the value of delta is 0. So area will be 0. So area will be 0. Now as soon as our t crosses here, it means t is greater than equal to 0. What happens? Our t is here. Then that integration will be what? The area under this thing will be 1 always. So it will remain always at 1. It will remain always at 1. Therefore, we can write integration delta lambda d lambda minus infinity to t equal to ut. Clear? Therefore, we can say that consider one LTI system whose impulse response is ht. Now we apply delta t, then we get what? Ht. This is our impulse response. Now we integrate it. Delta lambda d lambda minus infinity to t. So once we integrate this thing, when we integrate the input, then our result will be what? But this is what? This is equal to our ut. Then this one will also be our step response, yst. Integration h lambda d lambda minus infinity to t. So this is called our step response. That is, once we apply step input, the corresponding output is called step response. When we apply impulse input, the corresponding output is called impulse response. Now for the same LTI system, if we integrate ut, this is called actually the running integral. Note that this is our definite integral because the limits are fixed. But this type of limit where the upper limit is changing actually. The upper limit is a variable. This is called a running integral or moving integral. So our ut is the running integral of impulse function. Similarly, it can be proved that the running integral of step function is equal to rt. Okay? So you have to prove that. So I am not writing it here. So that this is equal to RT, ramp. Then what is our ramp response? It will be equal to YS lambda d lambda minus infinity to T. So that is, this one will be there. So this is called, that is called ramp response. Similarly, for the LTI system, if we apply the running integral of ramp function, it can be proved that this is equal to our parabolic function PT. Then what will be our output? YPT, parabolic response. It will be Y R lambda d lambda minus infinity to T. So it's parabolic response. Parabola response. Therefore, what we can write, our PT, when we differentiate ddt, we get ut. When we differentiate further, we get delta t. Similarly, if we integrate it, that integration must be a running integral, minus infinity to t. Okay, minus infinity to t, then we get it in the reverse direction. So in the chapter of singularity function, I told you the integration, but what type of integration it would be, that I didn't discuss that time intentionally. It is not a definite integral. It will be always a running integral. Then only the resulting function will be another function of time. It will be another function of time. So this way we are getting all these particular things. Clear? So it's actually page number 2. Okay. Next. Any question? No. Now 3. Next we discuss another concept. You already know the concept of convolution. So convolution is a particular operation that gives us another function of time. Okay. And we already know the physical significance of convolution. Similarly, there is one more mathematical function that we call it correlation. Correlation. It has two parts. The correlation of function, it has one is called a cross correlation, and another one is autocorrelation. Let's see the cross correlation first. Now, what is that? The cross correlation okay, of two signals xt and yt is defined as R xy p. I am writing p, which is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, okay, x lambda y lambda minus t, okay, d lambda, okay, or we can write it as x lambda plus t y lambda d lambda minus infinity to plus infinity. Here the first function is the leading function, the second function is the lagging function. Here the second function sorry there is a mistake it's not t
it will be
just 1 minute. I write it fresh. R x y p equal to integration x t y t minus p dt minus infinity to plus infinity, or x t plus p y t dt minus infinity to plus infinity. After integration, when we put the limit with in place of t, there will be no t finally, because the limits are there. Substituted in place of t, it will be a function of p only. The first function is the here. The first function leads the second by p, or the second function lags the first function by p. So after substitution of limits in place of t, once the integration is complete, there will have no t finally. It will be a function of the p. P is called lag parameter. The resulting function will be always a function of p, the lag parameter. Note that here obviously x t and y t are assumed to be real functions of t. Clear? They are assumed to be real functions of t. In case, okay, they are complex functions of t, then our r x y p will be equal to integration x t y t minus p star dt. Star is the complex conjugate. You can put a cap also if you want, or x t plus p y t star dt. The second function will undergo complex conjugate. Here also, complex conjugate. Get my point? Complex conjugate. Now you can ask one question. Okay, we have defined one particular integration, fine. But what is the physical significance of this particular thing? Let's explain this thing now. The concept is important, so we have to understand that particular thing. Okay, consider that we have one function x t versus t, something like this. And our y t is something like that one, epsilon. Clear? Now we introduce, okay, some delay in the second function. So what it will be? Y t minus p. The ink is just finished. Just wait. I bring one pen. Okay, so we are back. So we introduce a delay. Y t minus p. That one. So the function is delayed. So it is delayed by p. So it will be p and p plus epsilon. Now we multiply first function with the second one, third one. So x t y t minus p. So after multiplication, what it will be? So for different p, the placement of the second function will be different on the t-axis. When p is zero, it will be something like. When p is not zero, it is something like. So for different p, the placement will be this one. Okay, so for different one, so it changes. Okay, position changes. Position of yt changes for different p. Okay, therefore their multiplication will be different. Once you multiply it for a particular p, when p equal to 0, what it will be there? The function, this function into that one. So result will be sum. The product will be these into that. So product will be something like for p equal to 0. When p is having for another value, okay, then it will be something different. When p is having another value, so the product changes. When p is having another value, this one, their multiplication will be something like that one. When p is having another value, this one. Okay, so this way, for other p, it will be different. Okay, so for the loop of the function is different for different p. For different p. Hear my point? Now, once we integrate them for different p, what happens? Their area will be different. In one case, area is small. As p increases, area will be more. Area is maximum, then area decreases. So its area will be something like this one. So it is the area under the function. So it is equal to area under xt yt minus p for different p. So it is not t. So it is the plot of the area against p. So for different p, if we plot the area with respect to p, so it is the area will be something different. So note that when the area will be zero, when the area is zero, when there is no overlapping between x and yt minus p. So the area is zero. That is, the cross correlation between the two functions, okay, is zero when at least one of the two functions is zero. One of the two functions is zero. This means there is no overlapping between the two functions for that particular p. for that particular lag parameter p. That's why its area is zero. There is no overlapping at all. So it means that no overlapping means. So it means that the cross correlation between two functions is having high value when the two functions are quite similar. Then their overlapping will be quite high for a particular range. So therefore, cross correlation represents the degree of similarity. The degree of similarity between two functions. When the two functions are quite similar, their degree of similarity is quite high. So their overlapped area will be of high value. In other words, their cross correlation will be quite high. But when their degree of similarity is very poor, then it means that their cross correlation will have quite a small value. When you cross correlate any signal with a noise signal, a noise is a random signal, you know? It has a positive and negative values arbitrarily. So for a perfectly random signal, if you cross correlate with okay, now so that is the concept of cross correlation, degree of similarity. Now you can ask one question, that why we are taking or why we are judging the degree of similarity between two functions with the help of cross correlation? Because we have another important method at our hand always, that if we take the difference between two signals, that is xt minus yt or yt minus xt, in general we call xt difference yt, then their difference, when this difference is zero, it means what? Our xt will be equal to yt. So the best way of judging similarity between two functions is to take their difference. If the difference gives a zero value, it means that the two functions are exactly similar. But one problem here is that when the two functions are very closely similar to each other, but not exactly similar, then xt minus yt or yt minus xt will not be zero. Then we really cannot conclude whether the two functions are similar or not. Okay. So it's a binary case, whether the two functions are fully similar or not similar. That's all. Fully similar or not fully similar. But any similarity between the two extreme cases cannot be judged by taking their difference only. In that case, any moderate level of similarity, any intermediate level of similarity can be ascertained by applying cross-correlation function. Okay, that's why it is very important. Say, one example I can give you, one practical example, say you are talking to a friend over mobile phone early in the morning. Now, normally the voice of your friend is something. But when your friend in the morning is just out of bed, is not in a full pleasant working condition, then the voice of your friend is something different from his or her normal voice. Okay. Still, you are identifying that, yes, it is the voice of your friend only and nobody else. How? Similarly, when you talk to your friend in the afternoon, when he or she is in full working condition, in full enthusiasm. Yes, it is the voice of your friend only and nobody else. In the night also, late night, when your friend is again very much tired, feeling drowsy, the voice or form will be different. Your friend may be suffering from cough and cold, from fever, any other disease, or may have some emotional breakdown, maybe laughing or crying. In all such cases, if you plot the voice waveform in the oscilloscope, the pattern of the waveform will be totally different, at least apparently. But in all such cases, you are able to identify that, yes, it is the voice of your friend only and nobody else. How? In all such cases, if you cross-correlate the voice waveform of your friend with his normal template waveform, one standard waveform, voice waveform, always you will find a high cross-correlation function. High cross-correlation function between the template waveform and the waveform at a particular point of time. So this high-valued cross-correlation function can tell that, yes, it is the voice waveform of your friend only and nobody else. In all such cases, the cross-correlation function judges the degree of similarity, not the exact similarity. It always judges the degree of similarity by which the owner of the voice waveform will be identified. Okay? So this is therefore very much important. In image processing also, the cross-correlation function has immense consequences. Say, I didn't see you because we are interacting in an online mode, virtual mode. If I see you suddenly in a fish market, I will not be able to identify you. If I see you in a shopping mall where you are really in a sophisticated body language and wearing the most fashionable dresses, I may not be able to identify you because I found you only in fish market where you were wearing a casual dress. Okay. So if I see you in different position, in different context, okay, I may not be able to identify you. Why? Because I was trying to judge you from your dress, from your spectacles, from your some superficial features only. Okay, from which I was trying to judge, I was trying to identify you, but I could not do it properly. But if I know you very much for years, okay, we have some intimacy, we have some long discussions, we are in touch with each other for long, then ultimately you as a person will become independent of your dress, independent of your body language, independent of your hairstyle or any other thing. I'll be able to identify you all the time in any situation. Means I am not judging you only just in a superficial manner. I am judging you only in terms of the degree of similarity. So the cross-correlation function applied to the image processing can be used to judge the degree of similarity between two objects, and therefore a particular object can be identified. Therefore, the cross-correlation function has lot of significances in our engineering context. Dear, so that's all about our cross-correlation function. When the two functions are real, then it will be something like that one. And when they are not real, at least one is complex, maybe two also, then the second function will undergo complex conjugate. And one more thing I can tell you, that this expression is something like the expression of convolution. Only difference is, instead of T minus P, in convolution we use P minus T. In convolution we use P minus T. Our T is varying from minus infinity to plus infinity, and P is also varying from minus infinity to plus infinity. Therefore, easily we can say that this is equal to actually the convolution of first function with the second function, time reversed. So it will be y minus t. So if you apply convolution of first function with the time reversed version of the second function, effectively we will just arrive at the concept of cross correlation. So that is this particular thing. And here also same thing. Here if we apply convolution in convolution to the P minus T, where p is also varying from minus infinity to plus infinity, can be anything. T is also varying from minus infinity to plus infinity. So in that case, it will be xt convolved with y minus t star, complex conjugate. So a convolution of two functions where the second function is reversed in time is obviously the cross correlation between two functions. And evidently, we can say it's very easy to prove that our xyp is not equal to our yxp. In the first case, y is the second function, okay, which is lagging the first function. And in the next case, our yx, x is the second function and it lags the first function by p. So they are not equal. Okay, they are not equal. Clear? So that is this particular thing. Now, another thing is that, so that's all about the concept of cross correlation. Now, what's about the autocorrelation? Okay. Page number 5. The autocorrelation. Now, in autocorrelation, actually, the one signal is cross correlated with itself. So it is Rxxp equal to integration xt into x t minus p dt, minus infinity to plus infinity, or xt integration x t plus p into xt dt minus infinity to plus infinity, or we can write xt convolved with x minus t. Okay, that is the autocorrelation. Okay, autocorrelation between two functions. Now, when xt is complex, then Rxxp equal to integration xt into x t minus p dt. There is one complex conjugate, or integration xt plus p into xt star dt minus infinity to plus infinity, or it will be xt star x minus t star. This star means it is the complex conjugate, and that star is the convolution. Okay, so that is the concept of convolution. Okay. Now, note that our Rxxp has finite value. The area will be finite when xt is a time-limited function. Time-limited function, or you can write a transient function also. Okay, then only its area will be finite. That is when xt is an energy signal. Xt is an energy signal. There now. So then only our, so that definition is applicable for, okay, this autocorrelation or cross correlation when our xt and yt both are energy signals. Now, what is our x0? That is the autocorrelation at zero lag. Autocorrelation at zero lag. So our p is zero. Lag zero. So you put p equal to zero here. Here you put p equal to zero. So you can write it is xt into, so it is x square t dt minus infinity to plus infinity when xt is real. That is equal to E. That is energy of xt. And Rxx0, that is what? When xt is complex, here you put p equal to 0, so it will be integration xt into xt star dt. You put p equal to 0 here, so here xt is complex, so that is equal to what? Integration mod xt square dt, which is equal to E, that is energy of xt. So in general, whether xt is real or complex, it does not matter. Rxx equal to 0, Rxx 0 equal to always E, where for xt as energy signal. Clear? So that is one particular expression. Next, what happens if xt and yt, they are not energy signals, say they are, we can say, is the power signal or periodic signal rather. So next we see, when xt and yt are periodic signals, that hence power signals. We know all the periodic signals are power signals. Then what happens? Then our Rxyp equal to integration xt into y t minus p dt, that one, okay, sorry, then the limit will be different, xt plus p y t minus p dt, the limit will be what? Some t0 to t0 plus capital T, t0 to t0 plus capital T. What is capital T? T0 is any initial time, t0 is any initial time, and our capital T is what? Our xt is periodic, yt is also periodic, okay, but if their periodicity is different, then capital T will be the LCM of their periodicity. Capital T is LCM of the periodicity of xt and yt. Say example, say xt has a periodicity of 3 seconds. Okay, 6 seconds say. Say xt has a periodicity of 6 seconds and yt has a periodicity of 10 seconds. So one is a periodicity of 6 seconds and yt has a periodicity of 10 seconds. So what is the, when we multiply them, the product will have a periodicity. But when? What is the duration of the periodicity? After at what time the product will be repeated? The repetition duration will be, or the periodicity will be, the LCM of the period. That is the LCM of 6 and 10. LCM of 6 and 10 is, we know, 30. So in 30 seconds, the product will be, after 30 seconds, the product will be periodic, repeated. Same pattern will repeat. So in 30 seconds, since xt has a periodicity of 6, so it will repeat 5 times. And yt will repeat 3 times because its periodicity is 10. In 30 seconds, it will repeat 3 times. But the product will repeat only once in 30 seconds. The complete product, the pattern, the complete pattern of the product will repeat only once in 30 seconds. That is in LCM, that is the LCM of the two period, individual periodicity. Or time periods. Okay, so that then our, in computation of their cross correlation, we take that thing, and not only that, we will take the average of these two things. That is the average of this particular. Just we take the area over one cycle by the cycle. So that is the average, because the same pattern will repeat after that. So it is the average of the area of overlap function. It is the average of the area of the overlap function.
Clear?
So that is the definition of this, and then only we will have a unique nature of cross-correlation function. We will have a one unique nature of cross-correlation function. Clear? Now, okay, so here what happens? Where xt and yt are real. When xt, yt are complex, no problem, only one star will come. Rxyp equal to 1yt. Okay. So better I write 0. It's better that t0 I write, because sometimes I may use that t0 or to the time period. So t0 to t0 plus capital t0, xt, yt minus p dt, there is a star, complex conjugate. Or t0 to t0 plus capital t0, xt plus p, yt star dt. Okay. That is this, when they are complex. Okay, now what's about the autocorrelation for, okay, autocorrelation. Correlation of a periodic signal xt . The things is relatively simple. Rxxp equal to 1 by t0 integration t0 to t0 plus capital t0 xt into x t minus p dt, or xt plus p into xt dt. Here xt is real and Rxxp equal to t0 is the time period of xt. 1 by t0 integration t0 to t0 plus capital t0 xt into xt star, xt minus p star dt, or 1 by t0 t0 to t0 plus capital t0 xt plus p xt star dt.
খাতাটা একটু উপরে তুলবেন.
Oh, right. Thank you. So, our xt is complex. Xt is complex. Now, if we find out the autocorrelation at 0 lag, what it will be? Now, Rxx0. This is the autocorrelation at 0 lag. That is equal to, when xt is real, put p equal to 0, 1 by t0, t0 to t0 plus capital t0, x square t dt. It is p, power of the signal, power of xt. Okay. When it is real, it is means xt is real. And when xt is complex, what it will be? It will be 1 by t0. So Rxx0. Okay. t0 to t0 plus capital t0. Xt into xt star. Just put p equal to 0 dt. Or 1 by t0 integration t0 to t0 plus capital t0. Mod of xt square dt. That is equal to P. That is power of XT when XT is complex. When XT is complex. Yeah. Therefore, I can summarize the whole discussion of autocorrelation at 0 lag that way. I just write it in the next page, the summary. So it's page number 5, 6, it was 7 then. So it's page number 6. So 7. Therefore, Rxx0 equal to E when Xt is an energy signal. It's energy. And P when Xt is a power signal or periodic signal actually, in particular. So that is our one important thing. And here also we get that this particular thing. That is this summary. Yeah. Now I want to give you a problem. Okay. Problem. Find the autocorrelation function, autocorrelation function of the signal xt equal to e to the power minus at ut. Hence, find its energy. Just 1 minute. So we start with the definition of cross correlation RxyP. Acha, shono, arekta kotha. Thursday te amar department te ekta kaj ache. Amake ektu 11ta theke Gandhi Bhavane thakte hobe, eshob aro kichu kaj ache. Thursday, ami jani na kotay firbo. Barite na firle to class nite parbo na. তোমাদের থার্সডে বিকেলের দিকের কি অবস্থা? অথবা ফ্রাইডেতে হতে পারে, ফ্রাইডেতে তোমাদের কি অবস্থা?
স্যার থার্সডেতে আমাদের বিকেলে দুটো ক্লাস আছে, আর মানে থার্সডে সারাদিনই ক্লাস আছে।
ফ্রাইডে
থার্সডে ফ্রাইডে তে স্যার সকালে হবে।
সকালে কখন হতে পারে? Cross correlation. Now our xt is that one, so we can put the value. Eto somoshya hoye geche na ekon ei department e office kora ar barite class nawa dutu alada jayga hoye geche bole problem hoye geche. Location ta eki hole kono problem hoy. So it's just we put t plus p in place of t here. And xt e to the power minus at ut dt. So here we can write it e to the power minus ap right? So that is this particular thing. Now we cannot ignore this u, because actually these step functions are creating some trick actually in the treatment. So let's see what is that. Now ut plus p, that is equal to 0, okay, for t plus p less than 0 or for t less than minus p, and is 1 otherwise. And ut equal to 0 for t less than 0 and 1 otherwise. But what is the value of p? So there are several cases. So first I take case 1. I assume p is greater than 0. So it means what? Minus p is less than 0. Now in the number line, what I do? It is a 0. It is a negative line. Is the line for negative numbers the line for positive numbers. So our minus, when p is positive, our minus p is negative. Okay. So our minus p is somewhere here. Okay. And ut plus p, it is 0 when t is less than minus p. Otherwise it is 1. So from minus p onwards, our ut plus p is equal to 1. Okay. And ut is what? It is 1 only for t greater than 0. So ut equal to 1 only the right side. Therefore, our ut plus p into ut, that is equal to 1 when? Okay. That is equal to 1 when t is in between 0 to infinity. And it is 0 elsewhere. Their product. So in that integration, therefore, all that is minus infinity to plus infinity, but this is 1, the product is 1 only in the range of 0 to infinity. Otherwise, it is 0. So minus infinity will not be considered. It will be effectively 0 to infinity. So here it will be, limit will be changed from 0 to infinity. So I write it in the next page. So rxyp will be equal to e to the power minus p integration 0 to infinity. And this is 1 in that range. So that will not come. So I write it in the next page. Page number 8. So we can write rxyp equal to e to the power minus ap integration 0 to infinity e to the power minus 2at dt. So it's very easy to integrate. So it will be minus 2at by minus 2a, 0 to infinity. It will be minus infinity, 0, and it will be 0, 1. So it is e to the power minus ap by 2a. Okay, so it is our rxyp, where p is positive. Now we consider case 2. In case 2, we will consider p less than 0. P can be anything, the black parameter. So you have to consider all the cases. So case 2, p less than 0. It means our minus p is greater than 0.